From the Wisconsin Statute Book, 1961. There shall be chosen, at an election held in each precinct of the state, on the first Tuesday of April in each year in which electors for president and vice president are to be elected, delegates to the national convention of each party to nominate candidates for president and vice president of the United States. One of the 1,308 delegates to this year's Republican convention was a man named John Bosshard. Like one-third of the delegates, he is an attorney at law. But John Bosshard is also a Wisconsin farmer, and he knows as much about cows as he does about courtrooms.
We've only had them this year. We had them a number of years ago, but we've concentrated on dairying recently because of the necessity to go to bulk tanks and all the other things that we have to have with the grade A market, so that you can hardly afford to be in two specialties. To go into this expense, you've got to have volume, because the per unit profit is very small, and you just can't diversify on the average size farm.
So you have to have certain machinery to...
That's right. And you've got to have managerial skill.
This is the land, the green, steep-hilled coulee country rolling on down to the Mississippi River that marks the western boundary of the state. The Bosshards belong here. John's grandfather was the first white child born in La Crosse County, outside the city of La Crosse. His great-grandfather arrived in the year 1850 with a group of Swiss settlers. And for 114 years, there has been a Bosshard plot in this cemetery. This is the town. John lives in Bangor with his wife, Rilla, and their four children. Their house, like the village itself, is substantial, but not pretentious. The Bosshard business day begins early. Most of John's clients are farmers, men who are up at dawn and ready to confer right after the morning milking. This is one of the 2 days a week that he takes the short drive to his Bangor office. His is a general practice, dealing with problems of probating wills, with auto accidents, with arguments about fence lines.
And we're expecting another child around the time of the Grinch's first birthday, which is the 14th of September. And now for the weather, we have a forecast of fair to partly cloudy. Little change in temperature today, tonight, and tomorrow. Expected high today in the upper 80s. Yesterday's high was 91. Low tonight in the lower 60s, the low last night was 65. River this morning, 4 5/10 feet. That's up 1/10 of a foot from yesterday.
Here he has practiced since 1947, when he returned from the war, opened the office, and entered Republican politics. His first meeting this morning is with the treasurer of the Newburgh Corners Cooperative Cheese Factory, who is driven over to discuss a tax matter.
Morning, Ray.
John is the only attorney in Bangor, but he is not the only attorney in La Crosse. 4 days a week, he commutes 18 miles to his La Crosse practice.
Please state your name. Where do you reside? And what is your relationship to Agnes Buzzard?
John knows many people here in the 3rd Congressional District. He was the county DA for 2 terms, and he's a member of the Elks, the American Legion, the VFW, the First Baptist Church, and a lieutenant governor of the Kiwanis Club.
My country is a free land of liberty, of the Ivy. Land where my father died, land of the children's pride, from every mountain side, let freedom ring. Be present at our table, Lord, here and everywhere, Lord. These tables bless and grant that we may dwell in paradise with Thee. Amen.
But beneath all of this bucolic and small-town geniality, it turns out that John Bosshard is a knowing, clear-headed politician.
Our two-party system is as weak as it is on paper, where you see the Byrds and the Humphreys in one party and the Javits and the Goldwaters, if you will, in another, still making an effective approach in national politics. I think that we've done quite well in this problem of mixing government and business, and that's what we're doing now, and to get the guidelines so that we meet the needs. It's probably good to have no parties that are so fixed on a given point that they can't be affected because they won't have a majority. You've got to blend these thoughts together. And so it would seem to me it's not good politics on the part of good citizenship on the part of an individual to say, I'm going to sit this one out if so-and-so doesn't get elected, or I think you've got to make a decision as to where your basic philosophy lies, and if it lies in one party or the other, this is where you are going to have to vote, even though you might disagree very vehemently, even with that candidate, because the candidate will not be the total determinant of what happens in his administration. He's going to have to do business with the rest of the representatives and senators, and as a result, his will be a moderate program, as we have seen at least in recent administrations.
How do the nominees communicate with the delegates?
Well, most of my communication has been from individuals. I have had just a tremendous amount of mail. I received this morning, I think, about 16 pieces, handwritten or hand-typed, from individuals, to say nothing of all the mail that we've gotten from the city of San Francisco, the hotels. You can charge anything, apparently. I don't know if they've checked my credit or if they think every delegate is responsible. If he can get out there, I suppose, he ought to be able to pay his bills out there. Even Las Vegas has gotten into the act with a fine brochure, and it's a temptation to stop there on the way or coming back.
Now, do these things go into making your decision?
Yes, I think the obvious interest of so many people in this campaign are a factor that one has to weigh. We're interested in selecting a candidate who fits within the party framework and also who can get elected. And his grassroots support is a significant and important thing for a delegate, it seems to me, to consider. That is that my own judgment as to the character and the principles and the effectiveness of the candidates of the particular individual will be the determining factor, ultimately, as to who I would cast my ballot for.
Eisenhower meets Goldwater, they're both now in hot water.
Goldwater stands 250 for $1. The man, the jock, Senator Barry Goldwater.
No, with Strictly Goldwater here. We don't speak that word, Scranton. But...
The Bosshards in San Francisco. John has brought the whole family along. There's serious business ahead, but you'd never know it to walk down Powell Street with them, or into the jammed and noisy lobby of the St. Francis Hotel, convention headquarters. Then around into the headquarters of the 30-man Wisconsin delegation, and the pleasant moment that comes when you find a familiar face far from home. When a delegate meets a delegate, they immediately begin to speculate.
I'd like to have you meet Mr. Crane. This is my wife.
How do you do? How are you?
The days of decision begin. John attends the first Wisconsin caucus, where the speaker is Representative John Burns. The delegation is pledged to Burns as a favorite son. Only he can release them to vote for another.
This is the first time in modern history, at least, that Wisconsin has sent a delegation to the National Convention that was unpledged and uncommitted to any of the seriously considered candidates for nomination. Now, we'll meet tomorrow morning. The meeting is called for 9:15 with Senator Barry Goldwater.
At this point, John Bosshard has told nobody how he plans to vote. The delegate will listen carefully to both Goldwater and Scranton as they come separately before the Wisconsin delegation.
And, if you would accommodate us now, some of you can come out this door here, those that are up front and the rest.
But the press will not listen to them. John Burns spends the first 10 minutes ejecting newsmen and cameramen.
How many matches have you passed out at Gates today? Half a million?
Well, not the local. It's state, running for state. If I ran for the Senate again, I'd do just like always. I get up about 5 in the morning and start going.
Good.
But at the national level, like, golly.
Oh, yeah, you got to hit me.
Me where the ducks are.
Behind this closed door, the delegate listens to Goldwater, then Scranton. And he tries to make a sensible appraisal of them in the midst of the lights and the action and the cameras.
I would say that Bill Scranton's presence was a little less easy than Goldwater's had been, particularly in view of his implied, if not direct, criticism of the platform. Since our Mel Laird is chairman of that committee and the group feels very strongly about him, any criticism of the platform is indirectly a criticism of him, and I think this accounted for, at least in part, the uneasiness that the delegation had toward Mr. Scranton. Ultimately, Laird and Scranton are going to get together. They've been meeting with Eisenhower, and they're going to make a determination, particularly on the three issues that Scranton has now made.
Southbound on the Bayshore Freeway. It'll be a familiar freeway to delegates and newsmen in the next week, for it leads to the Cow Palace. Goldwater has the most signs, including an oddly informal one painted on the side of a hill. On this one, 1964 has been changed to 1864. This is a big and exciting moment as the delegate from the 3rd District walks with his wife and his alternate toward the convention hall. They're not the only ones that are excited. People who are for Goldwater are excited, and so are people who are against Goldwater. Almost everybody wants to make his position clear with a button. The Cow Palace was originally built as the San Francisco International Livestock Exhibition Hall, but it's the nickname that stuck. Here is where all the decisions will be made clear.
It is tremendous. And when you read all the polls and we're dead, it's amazing they've got this much enthusiasm for the thing.
Great. Well, got them.
John Bosshard will not soon forget the sights or the sounds as he moves for the first time down the aisle of the great echoing arena.
Mr. Senator Jab, it's a meeting we're there.
But... I remember lacrosse.
Certainly
good to see you again.
The Bosshards, how are you?
Fine.
It's nice to see you again.
One thing he learns quickly, if you want to get anywhere on the delegates' floor, you have to push. In the next 4 days, the delegate will spend 38 hours on this floor, looking, listening, thinking, laughing, talking, and pushing.
You're mad at me for sick of these guys, aren't you?
No, I love them.
Okay. Of the former president, welcome Ike and Mamie.
As with every political convention, the early moments are ceremonial and convivial. The grand old man of the party arrives to plead for unity.
A great chasm of public prejudice and lack of information separates from millions of independents and those Democrats who, being thoughtful, are also disenchanted. We simply must find better ways for bringing the truth to all these people.
And And the delegate listens to another plea. This is the keynote address by the governor of Oregon. He pleads for unity.
Every progressive spirit is opposed by 1,000 men appointed to guard the past. And this administration...
And the experienced politician predicts for his son John, a convention page, that they're going to have trouble finding complete unity.
It is essential that this convention repudiate here and now any doctrine. Whether communist, Ku Klux Klan, or Blucher. And make no mistake about it, the hidden members of the John Birch Society and others like them are out to do just that.
Rockefeller, Scranton, Romney, and a long parade of other speakers support platform amendments on civil rights, nuclear control, extremism. The delegate listens and comes to his own conclusion about the real value of the amendments.
Well, I voted against the amendment in each and every instance, and all the amendments that were presented to the delegation tonight. I think it's quite apparent that the propositions that were presented were oriented primarily to establish an issue for the one or the other of the political candidates for president, and that they did not substantially alter the platform as presented by the platform committee.
But this is a vacation too, and no San Francisco vacation is complete without boarding a cable car at the Powell and Market turntable. The Bosshards and 400 other people climb onto a car designed for 40. Fortunately, there's plenty of standing room. Now they're on their way up to the top of Nob Hill, and then even higher, up to the top of the Fairmont Hotel, where they eat lunch overlooking what many people believe is the fairest city in all the world. It's a momentary respite from the windy political oratory at the Cow Palace, as the children tell their father about Fisherman's Wharf and about that crazy block on Lombard Street that twists up the face of the hill like an imaginative snake. But the pleasant family lunch is all too short. John leaves early, heading back for the Italian Room at the St. Francis and the most important Wisconsin caucus of them all.
He opened the meeting and asked for discussion. There was discussion. In mid-discussion, there was his statement that he released the delegation. Then there was a discussion as to when a ballot should be taken by the delegates, whether they should wait till tonight or do it now. And they determined that they would do it now. The ballot was taken. It was 26-4. It was agreed that Mr. Burns would then have a press conference that would, in which he would release us to the press. It's being held right now. And this was the whole tenor of the meeting. We're going to be united when we leave here to go back to Wisconsin, regardless of our personal convictions, and attempt to elect Goldwater and carry Wisconsin.
And then as a delegation, you feel firm?
As a delegation, we feel firm. That is correct. The informal ballot. I voted for Scranton.
And let's give that philosophy of the peddler grandson a chance. So with the platform, as our charity comes in, with the militant son of an immigrant...
The informal Wisconsin ballot was 26-4 in favor of Goldwater. Though John voted conscientiously for William Scranton, the 30 Wisconsin ballots, including his own, will be cast on the floor of the convention for Barry Goldwater of Arizona.
And to keep government from becoming the master instead of the servant of the people. And I'm proud to nominate my colleague from Arizona to be the Republican nominee for President of the United States.
It's the biggest and most expensive spontaneous explosion of the week.
A dedicated American and a devoted Republican
William Warren Scranton of Pennsylvania.
By now, the convention has swung wildly toward Goldwater, but you'd never know it to listen to the last-ditch Scranton people. And finally, after the delegate has heard endless nominations, endless seconding speeches, and an endless assembly of every political cliche in the book, comes the roll call, the vote.
Arizona, 16 votes.
Mr. Chairman, Arizona, the birthplace and the home of the next president of the United States, proudly cast 16 votes for Senator Mary Ann Goldwater.
The United States paradise in the Caribbean, the true showplace of democracy, where all men are equal, we take great pleasure and pride tonight in casting our three votes for that great American, Governor William Scranton.
Humbly grateful that we can do this for America. South Carolina cast 16 votes for Senator Barry Goldwater.
The convention at its crashing climax. It's a time of fabulous success for some, of continuing conflict for others.
As I say, sometimes people are poor winners, and there are some who take we had a lot of letters and a lot of correspondence by this kind of person who says there isn't any other alternative. It's Goldwater or nothing, period. And those people don't forget. I find in politics it's this way. There is a certain kind of person that doesn't forget, ever. If you ever do it wrong, you are done. We're all caught up in the emotions of this thing right now. I think when these people get home and get back to their business and meet their fellow villageites and cityites, they will shift back into a pattern of somewhat more moderate views than they can express here, where they've got an overwhelming majority, where they rather are enjoying the strength that they do have here. I don't think that will disturb us at all. I think that we will be able to go back in Wisconsin, at least, and be very united.
John, do you think you feel differently about conventions now after your first one?
When I came out here, I thought it really would be very dull because this thing is pretty well cut and dried. There isn't what is there for me to do out here? But I think this has been a very interesting convention because of the philosophical cleavage that we have here. This is going to be important to the Republican Party for a long time to come. I'm looking forward to seeing how this thing turns out.
I present him to you tonight simply in this way. He is the man who earned and proudly carried the title of Mr. Conservative. He is the man who, by the action of this convention, is now Mr. Republican. And he is the man who, after the greatest campaign in history, will be Mr. President. Barry Goldwater.
Part of these proceedings have been carried on Telstar in order to make this aspect of the American political scene clear to the people of Europe.
accept your nomination with humbleness, with pride, and you and I are going to fight for the goodness of our land. Thank you.
The delegate has come to the end of the long sit and the long look and the long listen in the Cow Palace.
All those in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed, no, the motion is carried, and the convention stands adjourned, sine die.
One last crash of the gavel, and the great purposeful circus is over. Back on that Wisconsin hillside, John Bosshard said, "It would seem to me that it's not good citizenship on the part of a person to say, I'm going to sit this one out if so-and-so doesn't get elected." The delegate from Wisconsin, whose heart was with Scranton, but whose hat now says Goldwater, collects his children and begins the long drive home.